myself, I give myself to you. Give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Yes, I do, Lord. Give myself away so you can use me.
Now, give myself away. How many's got a praise tonight? Amen. I said, how many's got a praise tonight? I said, how many's got a praise tonight? Amen. Amen. I get excited when I think about what Jesus has done for me. Amen. Brother Stephen preached an outstanding message last night, and he talked about blind Bartimaeus. When he turned and walked away, he believed he got healed as he walked. I believe as he walked, he was singing, nobody can do me like Jesus. I really believe that. I believe as he walked, he would say, nobody can do me like Jesus. Would you look at your neighbor and say to your left and to your right, nobody can do me like Jesus? If you really mean it, say it to him. Nobody can do me like Jesus. Amen. Whew, nobody can do me like Jesus. Amen. The brother talked about there's nothing like that anointing. And I remember last year I asked in the opening day of the revival, how the anointing would just come on you sometimes. And it would just melt away everything. Anybody ever experienced that? Be driving down the road in your car and all of a sudden you just felt a warm, oil-like feeling just running over you, and you felt the presence of the Lord, and nobody was around but you and the Lord, and you begin to weep and you begin to cry and you begin to fellowship with the Lord. Anybody experienced that? I hope that's the way this service is tonight for you. I hope that's the way the altar service is for you. I hope the Lord just opens it up and pours it down upon you. Amen. We're going to take up prayer requests right now. And I'm going to start over here. Anybody's got any prayer requests? Okay. Okay. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else over here? Okay. All right. Amen. Anybody over here? Anybody over here? Scott. Okay. Anybody else? Amen.
Remember Peggy Brown just had part of her lung removed due to cancer?
Anybody else?
Remember Frieda Bagley. She was in hospital. She's very sick. She's battling cancer.
Okay. If you just stand and lift your hands up to the heavens, let's remember all these requests, and let's remember tonight's service, altar service. Would you do that? Lord, we come before you, and we thank you, and we honor you, Lord, and we ask you to reach out and touch us, Lord. Touch the young people. Touch the adults. Those that need healing in their body. Those that need deliverance, Lord, we pray. Those that need the miracle, Lord Jesus. We pray and ask in your holy name, Jesus, that you would move in our midst and stir our hearts, Lord. Stir our minds, stir our hearts. Stir us up, Lord. Get us excited about you. Let healing come for the congregation, Lord. Touch Brother Fred. Touch the man with the staff and such. Lord, we just pray and ask in your holy name that you would stir our hearts, Lord. Lord, we just pray, Lord, we're believing in you, Lord. We're trusting in you. Lord, we pray and ask in your holy name, Jesus, that you would touch us and help us. Lord, in your name tonight, thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord, somebody. Amen. I'd like our ushers to come if they would. All the offerings goes to our evangelist. We pray that you would bless him. You know, I grew up on a farm, and how you sowed your seed into good soil had a lot to do with what you would harvest. You know, if you plant green beans where the soil is a little too fertile or a little too, they get bushy. You have to plant them in the right form of soil. And same thing with corn. You know, you got to be. And I believe Brother Adkins, his school of ministry and his mission work and his evangelism, I believe that's good soil. And I pray that you would just reach deep in your pockets tonight and bless him with what you're able to give for that blessing. Would you do that? continue to praise him right here. He's all in this building. I said he's all in this building tonight. His power and his glory is here. Woo! I said his power and his glory is here tonight. Whatever you need, I believe God can meet your need tonight. I believe that. Amen. Woo! I tell you what, I'm fired up. Well, glory, hallelujah. Woo, glory, glory, glory. Pastor, come on. Pastor Greg, come on. Come on, no, come on. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. Come on. We're ready. Come on. We're ready. Hey, amen. We're ready, brother. Come on. Come on.
You might as well let the Holy Ghost have his way. I didn't leave my sanctuary to almost 1 o'clock this morning. We've been in revival all week, so I come in the Spirit. You're already in the Spirit. Why don't you just let the Holy Ghost do what he wants to do tonight? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Every breakthrough you need's already in this building. Every deliverance you need's already in this building. All the healing you need's already in this building. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Praise God. I understand preaching. I understand the importance of preaching. But I'm telling you, I know the importance of the move of the Holy Ghost. I have preached for days. Come on, somebody. Without this, come on, charging, surging of the Holy Ghost to try to break through to get to this point. Can you say amen? But when we're already at this point, it don't take much for you just to reach out and touch him. Reach out and let him help you tonight. He can break every chain. I'm telling you, last night, we've been in revival with an older sister evangelist. She's in her late 60s. And I'm telling you what, she took that pulpit last night and preached, he breaks every chain. Every chain. She read the scripture in Psalms where he says, the Bible says, God will put the solitary in families, and he will bring out them that are bound with chains, but the rebellious dwell in a dry land. And I'm telling you, the power of God hit that place toward the end, and I hadn't had the Holy Ghost surge me like that in quite a bit. Shouted me, slap out. I mean, I didn't even get to stand up. He shouted me out of my seat twice into the floor. Amen. We didn't leave till after midnight last night. I'm telling you, heaven's come down, and I feel him in this house tonight. All you need to do is respond to his Spirit, to the anointing of the Lord. It's already here. Hallelujah. The anointing's already here. Your breakthrough's already here. Your healing, your deliverance, whatever you have need of. Don't you get me in trouble with the Holy Ghost. And I've got a message that I've come with to preach here. And I'll preach it. But right now, you don't need to miss the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Letting him have his way tonight in this house. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Why don't you lay aside your religiosity, lay aside your fake premises that I'm okay, and say, Lord, here I am, and I need help tonight. I need more than a shout. I need more than a feel better. I need more than an emotional breakthrough. I need an inward breaking of the chains in my life. Hallelujah! God will set the solitary in families. in homes is what he said. He's going to take care of you. And he's going to bring them out that's bound by chains and deliver you. He said, this is what I can do. But the rebellious dwell in a dry land. So you can either let me do this, or you can remain disobedient, or in whatever's got you in bondage. Can you say amen? I watched a young lady last night move that hadn't moved in a long time. I hadn't seen the Holy Ghost move toward them. And all of a sudden they moved from their seat to the front. I'm telling you, this was right after that charge and that surge of the Holy Ghost. And she was praying, but then all of a sudden it stopped. And the pause, it almost like we went into slow motion in the Spirit. And the Holy Ghost paused. Because there was something somebody would not let go of. And the Holy Ghost said, as soon as you will let it go, I will turn the green light on. And we'll rush to your rescue and your help. But the Holy Ghost, there was something going on, something there they wouldn't turn loose of that the Holy Ghost didn't have jurisdiction over. So hear me tonight in this outpouring of the presence of the Lord. Whatever disobedience, whatever's holding you, whatever's got you distracted, whatever has you, you have to surrender it to the Lord. Because the Holy Ghost will not take jurisdiction over disobedience. Can you shout amen? Amen. But if you will yield it to the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I literally saw prayer warriors sitting around this young lady, but none of them could touch her. None of them could touch her. The Holy Ghost wouldn't let them. One lady said, I felt the Holy Ghost jumping out of me toward her, but the Holy Ghost couldn't move. There was no jurisdiction. There was something inside she had to release. Hallelujah. Can you shout amen? Amen. It was not just her. It was about five other situations in that same thing that needed that deliverance. And so I'm saying all that to say this tonight. Don't you miss your opportunity. Amen. To receive that tonight and be blessed. But y'all come in, Jeremiah. Y'all have ready tonight. Yeah, come on up. We're going to have our school come up and minister to you in song or whatever they have planned. It's an honor to be here tonight in the presence of the Lord. My daughter got to come with me, Kaylee. Amen. Stay standing so they can see who you are, darling. This is my oldest baby girl. We're glad you're here. It's such an honor to have our school and ministry with us. And I'm so proud of them. They were with you last night. And they're such a blessing. We miss them when they're gone, but I'm glad you were blessed by them. So glad to have all of you here tonight. I want you to get in and let the Lord have his way. You say amen. The Holy Ghost ain't done. Amen. He's still here. He's still going to help us and move tonight. Amen. We appreciate you so very much. And I'm telling you what, I have looked so forward. I enjoyed being here so much last year and enjoy the presence of the Lord. I have thoroughly looked forward to this conference. And it's like I told my evangelist last night. I said, I hope you enjoy being here. We want to bless you financially. And I said, and we want to make you feel welcome here. I said, I hope you enjoyed preaching to us. And I would like to say that tonight. I enjoy preaching to you. Amen. And I appreciate you so much for having that liberty for us in the pulpit. And you need to give yourself a hand clap for that tonight. Amen.
How many is thankful for the presence of God in this house tonight? I am thankful for what I feel. I'm thankful for what we feel in this house, what happened last night, and what I know is going to happen tonight and tomorrow night. We're not going to sing tonight. We're just going to do a drama. We got so many compliments and from last night. So we're going to do another one tonight. So I just want you to worship with us tonight as we do this drama before Pastor Greg preaches tonight.
Presence of the Lord is here. presence of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The presence of the Lord is here. Oh, the presence of the Lord is here. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Anybody feel it tonight? Spirit of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The Spirit of the Lord is here. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here. The power of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. The power.
Come on, reach up and get your blessing right now. Come on, reach up and get your blessing right now. Come on, I love that part of that sign language when he reaches up and grabs it. That I'm going to get my blessing. Some of you need to reach up and get it tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands all over this house and give him glory and honor and thanksgiving. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. I'll tell you what, you don't want to miss your opportunity, amen, to be blessed tonight. Can you say amen? You can get your blessing tonight and leave here changed by the power of God. Amen. Never to be the same again. If you allow him to work in your life tonight, he'll work and move. Amen. And have his way. Amen. What a wonderful atmosphere in the house of the Lord tonight. Good to see all the brethren. Amen. And visiting churches and visiting pastors. We don't want to miss anybody. And so we just say thank you for coming and being in the house of the Lord tonight. And just want the Lord to have his way. That's what it's all about. And let the Lord do what he wants to do in this house. Exodus tonight, chapter number 3. Exodus chapter number 3 tonight. If the Lord has smiled on us, thank you again for the places to stay. And we appreciate you for being a blessing to our students and all that you've done for them since they've been here. I want us to look tonight if the Lord would help us in Exodus chapter number 3. We're going to deal with quite a few verses tonight, and then we'll see where we go from there if we get into this and on into it for tomorrow night. If this way the Lord have us go tomorrow night. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and come to the mountain of God into Horeb. The angel of the Lord appeared unto him in the flame of a fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. Say this with me. And when the Lord saw that he turned, and when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am, or here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows, and I am come down. Can you shout praise the Lord? To deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up and out of that land into a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, into a place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression. He says, Moses, I've seen their affliction, and I've come down to do something about it. I have heard their cry, and I have seen their oppression.
And he says in to verse 9, Moses is enjoying this conversation. Moses is enjoying this experience. But then all of a sudden, it changes in verse 10. For then God says to Moses, "You come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." God says, "I've come down, and I've heard their cry, seen their oppression, and I'm about to do something about it. But in my doing it, I want you to partner with me, and we're going to do this together." Now the whole thing changes, because now God is saying, "You are going to come down with me, and you are going to go to Pharaoh, and you're going to say this." And soon as he did, and Moses, now listen to this, you're talking to the creator of the universe. I mean, you're talking to God Almighty. I know you're talking to God Almighty. And you start saying, "Well, who am I that I should go into Pharaoh and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?" And he said, certainly, God then responds to Moses' excuse and says, "Certainly I will be with thee. And this shall be a token unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God upon this mountain." Moses says unto God again. Now here God just says, "I'm going to be with you, son. I'm going to do this. I'm going to work powerfully." And then Moses says back to God, "Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel and shall say unto them, the Lord God of your fathers has sent me unto you, they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them?" And God answers the second excuse and reasoning and says, "I am that I am." And he said, "Thou shalt say unto the children of Israel, I am have sent me unto you." And God said moreover unto Moses, "Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has sent me unto you. This is my name forever. This is my memorial unto all generations." Everybody shout verse number 16. Go. "You come down, you go and gather the elders of Israel together and say unto them, the Lord God of your fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared unto me, saying, I am surely visited you and seen that which is done to you in Egypt." I'm fixing to bring deliverance. I'm fixing to work. I'm fixing to move. I just need you to do it. I just need you to walk in obedience. And I said, "I will bring you up out of the affliction. I'm going to bring you out of this affliction. I've not only told you this and telling you this now, but I prophesied this to your father Abraham, grandfather Abraham, hundreds of years before I even brought you into Egypt's bondage, that I'm going to bring you out. And they shall hearken to thy voice, and thou shalt come." He says, "Moses, you're going to go, you're going to say what I'm saying to you, and they're going to answer yes and going to come out with you. I'm giving you a done deal." Can you shout amen? "And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go. No, not by a mighty hand." In verse number 19, "And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with..." He says, "The king's going to rise up and fight you, Moses. But I'm going to turn around and fight him." Can you say amen? "And I'm going to give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. And it shall come to pass that when you..." Everybody shout, "Go."
"Go."
"You shall not go out empty." I'm not... Oh, I hope you're going to have church with me tonight. He said, "You're going to go. You're going to say what I'm telling you to say. And I'm going to bring deliverance. They're going to answer you and they're going to follow you. The king ain't going to like it. He's going to try to stop you, but he's going to try to rise up with a mighty hand. But I'm going to smite him. Then I'm going to give you favor with all the Egyptians. And you're not just going to come out, but you're going to come out, and you're not going to come out empty either. I'm going to give you a favor, but every woman shall borrow of her neighbor and her sojourneth in her house jewels of silver, jewels of gold, and raiment. You shall put them upon your sons and upon your daughters, and you shall spoil the Egyptians." You're going to come out, and you're going to come out with spoils. You're going to come out, and you're going to come out with blessings and bountifulness. I'm not only going to bring you out, but I'm going to bring you out with power. Can you see the done deal in this? The contract? He says, all I need you to do is just go say what I said say and do what I say do. And if you will walk in obedience, it's a done deal. I come to tell you tonight, it's a done deal. All I need you to do, God said, is just do what I told you to do, and everything's going to be all right. Oh, I don't know about you, but that makes me feel better with some of the situations I'm fighting and the enemy rising up. If I'll just do what he said do, there ain't nothing that can stop the church. And if it can't stop God, it can't stop the church. Somebody shouted, just can't stop him. He's saying all this. The king of the mightiest emperor on the face of the earth at that time ain't going to be able to stop me. But you standing here arguing with me is my only problem. That world ain't my problem. The devils ain't my problem. The governments are not my problem. My problem is you who's standing right here in front of me arguing with me. Oh. Now, can you imagine after hearing all that from the God who hung the stars? Moses says in chapter 4, and Moses answered and said, but behold, they will not believe me. They ain't gonna believe me. Nor hearken unto my voice, for they will say to the Lord hath not sent thee. And the Lord said unto him, here God he is again, having mercy on him, and said, son, they're going to hear you. If they don't want to hear you, this is what you're going to do. You're going to throw your rod down. Throw your rod down, Moses. Throw that staff down. And he throwed it down. It become a snake. He said, now reach and pick it up by the tail. Boy, there's preaching all in this now. You know you don't take no snake up by the tail. You pick a snake up by the tail, he's just going to bite you. You take him up by the head. You get a stick and get his head pinned down, and then you take his head and put your fingers on it. I ain't never done this. But I seen it done. They reach down and take that snake by the head so them things can't get you. And then you pick it up. You don't pick it up by no tail. But God's saying you're going to pick it up by the tail. Because I want you to know you ain't got nothing to do with this. It ain't in your power to take that up. It's in my power to take it up. You're going to pick it up by the tail, and you're never going to have any control over it. It ain't going to be your strength, your ability, your talent to tame that thing. It's going to be my power to tame it, and he's going to pick it up by the tail. He said, you're going to do this, and I'm going to let you do it. And God, come on, somebody. And he said, you're going to pick it up by the tail. It's going to become a staff again. Then you're going to stick your hand in your chest. You're going to pull it out. It's going to have leprosy all over it. And then you're going to stick it back into your chest, and you're going to pull it out. When you do, it's going to be made whole. And God shows him all this. Can you imagine? Now listen, not only have you just saw a bush burning, and now you have been talking to the God of the universe. He said, I've come down, I've heard that I'm going to do this, and I'm going to smite the king, and I'm going to do all this. But now your staff has just become a snake. And you just picked it back up, and it become a staff. Your hand just was withered with leprosy, and now it's made whole. I'm telling you, I'm ready to tackle the world now. I mean, I'm ready. I'm ready to shoot hell with a water gun. Come at me, devil. Come on, devil. Bring it on. Right? Right? Bring it on. Like one preacher said, I feel like running through a troop and leaping over a wall, because it's what Isaiah said. He got it messed up and said, I feel like jumping over a troop and running through a wall. He said, whoops, I messed up. He said, but I still feel like I could run across a troop and run through a wall, jump over a troop and run through a wall. Either way you put it, I feel like I can do it. You ever felt that way? Surely Moses ought to feel that way. But let's look and see what, after all of that now, Moses says unto the Lord, oh, my Lord. Oh, my Lord. I'd be saying, oh, my Lord, too, if a snake just come into my hand. But I'd be saying, oh, my Lord, let's go. Let's do whatever you say do. Now, look, He's got power to make staff serpent, serpent staff, hand withered, hand healed. But yet he's still standing here arguing with the will of a man. You're going to help me tonight, aren't you? Oh, my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore nor since thou hast spoken to thy servant, but I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. And the Lord answered him again in mercy and said, who hath made your mouth? Who hath made man's mouth? Who maketh the dumb or the deaf or the seeing or the blind? Am I not the Lord? Everybody say verse 12 with me now. Therefore go. Go and I will be with thy mouth. And I'll teach you what to say. He said, your healing is in your going. If you'll go, I'll heal you. If you'll go, I'll heal you. Moses, your inabilities mean nothing to me. I just need you willing to go. I'm taking my time because I want to build this foundation. I need you willing to say yes. Willing to go. Your mouth ain't a problem to me. Your stuttering's not a problem to me. Your slow speech is not a problem to me. I'm God and I can heal it all. I just need you willing. Now therefore go and I'll be with thy mouth and I'll teach thee what to say. And here he says it again. Oh my Lord. Oh my Lord. Send, I pray thee, by the hand to whom thou wilt send. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against him. And said, okay, is not Aaron the Levite thy brother? And I know that he can speak well. And behold, he cometh forth to meet thee. And when he seeth thee, he will be glad in his heart. And thou shalt speak unto him and put words in his mouth. And I will be with thy mouth and with his mouth and will teach you what you shall do. And God says, I'm going to have mercy on you. You made me angry for 2 chapters. You've argued with me. You've argued with me for 2 chapters. And I've had mercy on you. I could have just struck you dead. But you're still here. And even in his anger, he says, I'm going to let Aaron help you, but I'm still going to be with your mouth. 5 different reasons and excuses, and God answers them all. Can you say amen? So we get to verse 27 after this excuse is done. In verse 27, one verse. And the Lord said to Aaron. Everybody say it with me. Go. Go into the wilderness and to meet Moses. You ready? And he went. 3 words. And he went. 2 chapters arguing with Moses. But he said, Aaron, go. Aaron said, yes, sir. Father, in the name of Jesus tonight, I pray your holy anointing upon us. I pray you anoint us as never before to speak the words of life into this precious congregation of older, middle-aged and young people and children. Anoint us tonight to preach this gospel in your mighty name we pray. All the church shouted amen, amen and hallelujah. All the young folks shouted hallelujah. Hallelujah. 2 chapters of excuses. 2 chapters of reasoning. 2 chapters, just like tonight, the power and the presence of God has been so real. Saturate this place in such a manner that the dead could have got up. Lame legs could have walked. Blind eyes could have seen. In Haiti, when I've seen amen, lame people walk. In the Dominican last year, when I watched a lame child run across the floor, when I watched a blind girl, blind in her eyes, see, there was no difference in the level of the atmosphere tonight than there was that night. Even in Haiti, when I watched the witch doctor's daughter come in the side door, become a ravenous wolf, and get delivered, amen, and this 16-year-old witch doctor's daughter, the demons start crying for the witch doctor, and next thing you know, 30 minutes later, the witch doctor walks in and becomes limp and can't even stand and have to get her a chair, and she slides out into the floor. And all of a sudden, on top of that voodoo mountain, the voodoo capital of the world, their main witch doctor couldn't even stand in the presence of Jesus. And yet, Sister Leah was there with me. She'll tell you there was no difference in the atmosphere than what was here tonight. Can you shout amen? There wasn't no level of anointing that was greater than what was in this room tonight. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. It's just more seen and acceptable in a country like that because you have major issues. We got issues here tonight, but we just don't bring them out front and deal with them. We have this religious facade that I'm okay, I'm all right. We have to pierce through all that to get you to where you need to be to say, hey, I need help. But if a witch doctor's daughter, bound by demons, starts ripping her clothes off, acting like a ravenous wolf, can get deliverance, you surely can get deliverance in this house tonight. If a lame man that can't walk can start walking, you surely can start walking out of your valley, your trial, your battle, your storm. But it's buried deep on the inside, and it ain't bad enough yet. It's like the old farmer who had that dog, and the preacher went by to visit that old farmer in South Georgia. And all of a sudden, he talked to that farmer for a little while, and all of a sudden, that old hound dog said, "Arr!" Talked a little bit longer, and all of a sudden, that old hound said, "Arr!" Talked a little while longer, and that old hound said, "Arr!" Finally, that preacher said, "What's wrong with that dog?" That old farmer looked at him and said, "He's laying on a nail." The preacher said, "Then why don't he get up?" He said, "It ain't hurting bad enough yet." When it gets to hurting you bad enough where you are, you will latch hold of the atmosphere in this house. When the doctor says you've got 3 months to live, you won't be waiting on me to take the pulpit. You'll be running down the middle aisle in the middle of the presence of God saying, "I must touch him or else I'll die." I want you to understand that there is no limit to the power and the anointing and the glory of God. It's only the will of a man that God will not move beyond or break beyond. And you, whether you are 14 tonight, 18 tonight, 25 tonight, or 45 or 85, the power of God can raise 10 dead people in this building, but yet not move beyond your desire and beyond your will. Because he's a God that allows you the privilege of choice. Great God, Moses, if you seen and opened your eyes, but you couldn't get your eyes off of your inabilities and incapabilities, and you wrestle with God for 2 chapters, a life of excuses, of life of reasons, of life of why I can't, but yet Aaron hears one word and takes off and goes and does. Can you shout amen? You got to decide, I'm going to say this and then start over, whether you're going to live a life of excuses or whether you're going to live a life of passion, a life of drive. Why is it men and women and boys and girls can be in the house of God, raised, cutting their teeth on the pew, and yet a cold-hearted sinner walk in that back door, kneel down in this altar, and a matter of weeks already laying hands on people and doing more for God than somebody who's cut their teeth on the pew, done married, got children, and raising their children on the pew, and still hadn't done anything, and still hadn't been used of God? It isn't that God is a respect to persons. It's God will not move beyond your will. And we live life of excuse. Can I take this off and just be youth tonight? Amen. The will of a man, Moses wrestles with God for two chapters. The God of the universe talking to God. Can you imagine? I want you to understand tonight, Moses was minding his own business. He had done got away from Egypt. He had done got away from, amen, God and the people of God. And he's hiding on the backside of the desert. But God had already prophesied, amen, 400 and something years, even longer than that, several hundred years before that. He said to Abraham, I'm going to take your seed, I'm going to bless it. Then I'm going to take them down and they're going to go into Egypt's bondage. They're going to live there for 400 years. And when it's up, I'm going to bring them out with a mighty hand. I don't know how that don't mess with you like it messes with me to know that their deliverance was already prophesied before they were even a thought in their great-great-granddaddy's mind. Their granddaddy hadn't even been born yet. Come on, somebody. And God's already saying, I'm going to bring you out. That means there ain't enough devils in hell tonight can hold you where you are. That means if the Lord tarries, my great-grandchildren have already got victory waiting on them, and they ain't even a thought in my little girl's mind. Come on, my little girl's just dreaming about getting married, and God's already got my great-great-grandchildren's victory planned out, deliverance planned out, help planned out. He ain't, there ain't nothing can stop our God. There ain't nothing can hinder him, slow him down. With men, it might be impossible, but not with God. You ought to lift your hands tonight and say, I can come out if I want to come out. You need to turn around in a 360 and say to every devil that's around you, you're only holding me because I've allowed you to. But if I choose to come out tonight, there ain't a thing you can do to stop me. There ain't a You better enjoy your hold on me right now, because I'm about to come out of this. Woo! I'm about to shake this depression. I'm about to shake this discouragement. I'm about to shake this intimidation. You can't hold me. Give him a shout of praise. Hallelujah. That young lady could have rose up last night and said, devil, I'm going home defeated, not because you have the power, but I'm going home defeated because I just don't want to turn loose. Well, I sure wish somebody would have laid hands on me. Honey, you don't need nobody to lay hands on you. Well, I sure wish somebody would have come out and prayed the prayer of faith over me. You don't need nobody to pray the prayer of faith over you. This is the New Testament. You don't need me. You can pray it through yourself. You ain't got to find the prophet. You ain't got to find the preacher. Lay hands on yourself. You ain't here. I said, lay hands on yourself. You done come too late to tell me that. I lived in the house of hell itself. Drugs, alcohol, all the drugs I wanted. And I still had a move of God in my bedroom. I couldn't control the living room. I couldn't control the kitchen. And I couldn't control the outside. But that one little 12 by 11 bedroom was mine. And when I walked in it, it was a holy of holies. Because I was a child in their house.
house, but that was my bedroom. And the devil had jurisdiction in every other room in that house, but he didn't have jurisdiction in that room. They weren't enough of the power of alcohol and drugs that could overpower the power of the Holy Ghost. I come to tell some man, young man, some young lady, if you have a desire and a will to choose, then you got the power to live in the midst of hell itself. Moses has went and hid from God. And this is God's plan over hundreds and hundreds of years of prophecy. Do you know God's got wheels and purposes and plans for this area, for this Corbin, for you, for this church, that's been prophesied before you were even thoughts in your daddy's mind, or your daddy was even a thought in his granddaddy's mind? And all God needs is for you to show up. Are you following me? Moses, I done got it all took care of. I done seen the end from the beginning. I just need you to show up. I done told your great-great-great-great-granddaddy you was going to come. And I done made the way. I done got the plan. And I'm fixing to tear down the greatest empire known to man. And all I need you to do is show up and go. But you stand here and want to argue for two chapters. The Bible says that Moses was on the backside of that desert, and all of a sudden, he's watching sheep, and he sees a bush burning. And that bush is burning, but it's not being consumed. So the Bible says Moses' eyes get that attention, his mind gets the attention, that burning bush gets his attention, and the Bible said he sees that it's burning but not being consumed, so he turns aside to see that which is burning but not being consumed. And the Bible says when he does, that God saw Moses turn aside to see. Now, I want you to know, this is where I want to preach to you just a little while tonight before I go any further. When Moses saw that bush, he stopped what he was doing and turned aside to see. And God watched him turn aside to see. And the Bible said, the Bible specifically says, and he watched him turn aside. He saw him. When he saw him turn aside to see, then the voice started talking out and said, Moses, Moses, Moses. Can you shout amen? What God is saying to us is that bush was burning, but it wasn't talking. That bush was burning, but it wasn't talking. It was burning before he got to it. It was burning as he neared it, and it was burning when he saw it, and it didn't start talking until Moses turned aside to see it. God is saying, come on, some of you have never known nothing more than the burning bush in your life. And we get to shouting over the burning bush. And we get to rejoicing over the burning bush. But God is saying, if I can just get you to do more than shout and run when you see the bush burning, and if I can get you to take a step toward me and start nearing me, I'm not just going to be a burning bush on fire. I'm going to be a talking bush on fire. Am I boring y'all tonight? It's the will of God tonight that the moment you respond, his power filled this house. His anointing fills this house. But he will only fill this house, flow through this house, blow through this house, walk through this house. But if I don't turn aside, if I don't take a step, if I don't respond to his presence, all I just saw was the moving of the bush or the burning of the bush. And we are happy with the bush of burning, but God is saying to young men and women in this youth conference, I don't
want you just to know me as a burning bush. I want you to know me as a burning bush that talks. Some of you have experienced the burning bush, and you know what it is, to dance and to shout. But I come to tell you, that bush burning don't just burn for your entertainment. Don't just burn for your pleasure. But if God can get you on this Thursday night to turn aside and respond to the bush that's burning, that bush you've always thought just burned, it's going to start talking. You're going to go to the next level of the Spirit of God. Is there any young men and women in this house that'll lift your hands and say, I'm responding tonight? I'm not just going to watch it burn. You've watched the saints dance and shout. You've watched the saints rejoice. You've watched the power of God fall on the choir. You see it and you say, oh, glory. But God says, there's more to me than just seeing me burn. Hallelujah. Ooh, hallelujah. Some of you have never been beyond that burning bush experience. But God is saying tonight, if I can get you to respond, if I can get you to take interest, if I can just get you to turn aside, he'll see you turn aside. In the moment Moses turned aside and God saw his response, that bush started saying, Moses, Moses, amen. And he said, come on somebody, Moses, Moses. God's saying, I'm not just a burning bush called the Pentecostal church, but I'm a burning bush that can talk, and I'm gonna call you by your name. I know you by name. Moses said, great God, it ain't just a bush that's burning, it's a bush that knows my name. And he said, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here am I. Hallelujah. That's the second response. Some of you have been past the burning bush, you have turned aside, and you've heard your name called. You know him a little more personal. You know him a little more intimate. But I promise you, if you'll lift your hands and say, not just thank you, woo, thank you, I feel you, thank you, I see you, thank you, I hear you call my name. He said, I'm more than a bush that knows your name. If I can just get you to lift your hands and say, here am I, I'm going to let you know the next step you need to take. I feel the Holy Ghost in this house. I come to tell you, there's more to what you've experienced in God than what you've known. If you will just respond, if you will just take a step, if you just will move, you ought to lift your hands and I'd say, I'm not living a life of excuses. I'm going to live a life of passion. Heard me talk about my daughter. She's here tonight, 13 years old. Received the Holy Ghost when she was 4. Preached, prayed, prophesied for 2 hours when she was 10. Preached in Haiti. She's been on 4 missions trips before she's 13 years old. Preached in foreign countries. She knows what it's like at 10 years old to lay hands on a woman blind in one eye. And a tumor had been taken out of her head. She's got a hole in her skull right here where the tumor been taken out. And there ain't even no eyesight in that left eye because there ain't no brain that controls it. The part that controls her eyes has been taken out of her head. But my little daughter knows what it's like to lay her hands on that woman. Watch her hit the floor only to get up hollering, I can see. And don't even have a brain that controls the left side of her eyes. She also knows what it's like to lay hands in the same service and preach, pray, and prophesy. Lay hands on a woman with 4-stage cancer to find out 2 weeks later there ain't a cancer cell left in that woman's body. Hallelujah. He's more than a bush that burns. Hear me, Dorothy Pentecostal young people, Northern Kentucky or whatever, Eastern Kentucky. Amen, young people. He's more than a dancing experience. He's more than a tongue-talking experience. If he can get you to turn aside, If he can get you to come near, come nigh that bush, I know you see it and you shout. But he said, if I can get you to shout for a little while, but when you're done, walk toward me. Take a step toward me. Come near me. I'm more than a jump. I'm more than a jerk. I'm more than the bob of your head. I am a God who knows you intimately, personally, and I want to work and move in your life. Moses. And he says, here am I, Lord. He responds the second time. And he responds that second time and moves toward that bush. All of a sudden, God says, take off your shoes, for the ground you stand on is holy ground. All right, Moses, I didn't care what condition you was in when you saw me burning. I didn't care what condition you was in, because I love you unconditionally, when you drew near me and turned aside. And I didn't care what condition you was in when you said, here am I. But before you come any further, you got to take off your shoes, because I don't want what's nothing between me and you, because the ground you stand on is holy ground. Do you hear me? That's why you can be a cold-hearted sinner and know nothing about this and see the bush burn. That's why you can be a cold-hearted sinner and know nothing about this and hear the voice talk out of the bush. That's why you can say, here am I. But he says, if you want to come any further, and I want you to come further, but before you do, anything that's between me and you that separates you from my holiness, you're going to have to remove it and take it off of your life and take it out of the way, so there's nothing between me and thee. Ooh, don't get quiet on me now. I feel the Holy Ghost in this house. There's some of you have only know the burning bush. There's some of you have moved toward it and heard the voice. They've some of you gone to the next level and said, here am I. And there's some of you have gotten to the level where he has said, if you want more of me, if you want my anointing, if you want me to use you, if you want me to talk to you, Moses, if you want any know any more details of the story, Moses, you're going to have to take off your shoes, because the ground you stand on is holy ground. Great God, I feel the Holy Ghost in this house. Folks, that's why I can go to near about any church and preach, and the anointing shows up and heaven comes down, because he'll show himself in a burning bush. He'll talk out of a burning bush. But if you go into the next level of the anointing, and there's things between you and him, we're not going any further than till we get our shoes off our feet. Hallelujah to the Lamb. They've some of you get to one place and get stuck. You get to one place and get stopped. You get to one place and can't go no further. Why? Because the Holy Ghost don't have jurisdiction over your will, over your decision. And God is saying, Moses, I got something to say, but before I can say it, I got to remove anything that separates you from me. Hear me, congregation. Hear me, Dorothy Pentecostal Church. Take your shoes off. Take your shoes off. You already got yours off, don't you? I saw your socks out of the corner of my eye. I said, my God, what kind of shoes is them? I looked down and realized they ain't shoes, they socks. But the shoes ain't much different, are they? Praise God. Woo! Your shoes match your socks. I ain't letting you see mine. Praise God. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. He's already got his shoes off. Brother Greg, hallelujah. Take your shoes off, Brett. How easy was that? You know what God's saying to you? That thing
saying to you that that thing between me and you is not a hard thing. It's as easy as taking your shoe off. I said it's as easy as taking your shoe off. God said that thing that's between me and you, it's not a hard thing. It ain't a troublesome thing. It ain't a bad thing. It ain't an impossible thing. It's easy. Take your shoe off.
Babies, I come to tell you that pornography may look strong, but it's as easy as taking your shoes off. Somebody say somebody done took their shoes off, we'll start smelling something. Well, it's gonna stink when people start taking their shoes off. And it may stink a while in your life until you get them off. Come on, somebody. But it's because you've had them on way too long. Hallelujah. He said, I need you to get it off your feet because it's separating you from holiness. It's separating you from my purity. It's separating you from godliness. And I can't move around it. But I come to tell you, it's not. You've been sitting for 5 years, and all you got to do is take your shoe off.
I need 5 people that will testify by the lifting of both hands before you do that you wrestled with something for a long time, but when you finally gave in, it was as easy as taking your shoes off to lift both hands. Come on, lift them up. Now turn around, look at somebody and say, take your shoes off. That toxic relationship is as easy as taking your shoes off. Right, God, I feel like preaching. That devil's made you think it's a 10-foot giant. That devil's made you think it's the walls of Jericho. But God says the walls of Jericho ain't no different than just taking your shoe off. Hallelujah. They ain't nothing in my life. Woo! It's as easy as taking your shoes off. Look at the impossibility. Then look at it and say, you're this easy. You're this easy. I'm taking my shoe off. That's all I gotta do. I ain't gotta tear you down, Jericho. I just gotta take my shoe off. I ain't gotta bring you down, Pharaoh. All I gotta do is take my shoe off. You didn't hear me. God said, Moses, take your shoe off. Everything else is took care of. All I need is a simple obedience.
Pastor, you don't know how strong this is in my life. It's as easy as saying, tick, tick, tick. It's all right. Holy Ghost ain't gonna open it. I'm just kidding. My daughter thinks he can. I know we're close, but I am at a place in my life that God means more to me than this relationship. And it's distracting me and pulling me down. So I'm taking my shoes off. Come to church tomorrow night and you will understand.
Somebody shout, take your shoe off. Take your shoes off. Take your shoes off. You don't need 18 Holy Ghost filled mamas slapping you on the top of the head. Just take your shoe off. You don't need Tommy Bates, Greg Atkins, Reverend Sanchez, Todd Hoskins to lay hands on you. You just need to take your shoe off. You can take your shoes off in the middle of your bedroom. You can take your shoes off in geometry class. Whenever you get ready to take your shoes off, they ain't nothing can stop you. God says, Moses, take your shoe off. It's that simple. What is that thing that's separating you and God? What is that thing that you're struggling with that you can't just turn loose of? It's as easy as taking your shoe off. Moses, just take your shoes off. Just take them off. God, don't go to the next level. God says, some of you have known the bush. Some of you have heard the bush. Some of you have said, here I am. But some of you have gone as far as you can go because there's some things that he's not pleased with. And God says, you can keep shouting with the bush, and you can keep shouting with the voice, and you can keep shouting. But we can't go no further until you take off your shoes. What is that thing that's separating you? If you can give it up, you can have it all. I want to grab people sometime and say, that thing that you're holding on to, do you think he's not a good father and he won't give you that thing that you're trying to get on your own? If you would just give it up and do his will, he says, all these things will be. I will not leave nothing out. He says, Moses, I'm going to break down the most powerful emperor in the whole world. I just got to get you to take your shoes off. I just got to get you to remove that thing that's between me and you. Stand up, Dalton. I talk about Dalton most places because his testimony is just powerful. He was a wild teenage boy. A good boy, but a wild boy in the world. And I'm going to tell you something. Dalton came to our church at 20 years old. And had come to our church for 4 weeks before I even knew he came. And I didn't even notice him. And one Sunday after church, I spat there shaking hands. Sometimes I get to shake hands, sometimes I don't. He come by me and I shook his hand. I said, hey, Bubba. I said, how are you? I said, glad to have you today. He goes, Pastor, I've been coming here 4 weeks. I said, you have? He said, yes, sir. I said, well, where'd you come from? What church you from? I said, where'd you get saved at? He said, I didn't come from no church. I got saved here. I said, well, great. What did I preach on? He said, marriage. You were preaching on the family, and you was preaching on husbands and wives that morning. I said, and you got saved? He was under conviction. And the Holy Ghost was burning in a bush. And that boy turned aside. He got gloriously saved. I'm talking about gloriously saved. He got born again. Completely born again. Not just a praying. Something died in him and something came alive. He started seeking for the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He listened to me. Started seeking for the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He got to praying and seeking the Lord. And he looked at me one day. He said, Pastor, he said, am I something wrong with me? He said, because I don't have hardly a desire for anything in this world anymore. He said, I can't even watch television. He said, when I try to watch television, I get under conviction because I'm thinking, Lord, I could be studying your word. I'm sitting here, he's driving me. I'm sitting here in this pastor seat going, my God of heaven. I wish everybody in my church was on fire like this. And he's sitting there going, talking to me right down the road. And he's going, Pastor, he said, am I a freak? Because not everybody in our youth department, in our college department, is hungry for the word like this. But they have the Holy Ghost and they're talking in tongues. And he said, they want to play video games, but I would rather talk the Bible than talk word. And he's just going down the line. And he said, but am I crazy? Or I said, no, son, you ain't crazy.
He said, but I don't have the Holy Ghost like they do. I said, you listen to me. You got more Holy Ghost than some of these people been talking in tongues for 15 years. I'm on somebody. He said, then if God did this in me and changed me this way, then what are they got? I said, son, you got born again. He said, but if there's not a hunger in them for the word, something's wrong somewhere then, right, Pastor? And I said, yeah, baby, something's wrong. Are you listening to me? On fire. But it was as easy as taking your shoes off. I want to ask you tonight. I know I'm slowed down and I'm not shouting around the house. Because, see, folks, we had enough power of God sweep through this building a while ago that if we could have had the funeral home people here with the people dead. They could have got up. We had an accident yesterday out on my farm. And one of my puppies got ran over. And it killed it instantly. And I know that ain't that bad for y'all, but it was for us. She was the special one. She's the one I followed since she was this little from the breeder. And my little boy screamed and cried and screamed and cried. And I'm still crying this morning. And when I, 12:30 last night, he was laid up there on the chair, my chair on the platform. He said, Daddy, I ain't leaving till God raises Dolly from the dead. I ain't leaving till God raises Dolly from the dead. I said, baby, he can do anything. And I said, Daddy wants you to know he can do anything. I said, but sometimes God just don't do it. And we don't understand why. Now I'm having to deal with his little mind and heart at 11 years old. He said, but Daddy, I believe. I said, I know you do, baby. I said, but sometimes God allows things and we don't know why. I said, but you know what? I said, we're going to learn from this. Come on, somebody. But I saw his faith strong, Brother Curtis. He said, Daddy, I ain't leaving. You can leave me. I'm staying right here till Dolly gets up. He said, I'm going to go out and get her because we hadn't buried her yet because it happened right before church. He said, I'm going to go get her and I'm going to bring her here and I'm going to lay her beside me and I ain't getting up till she starts moving. Come on, somebody. Thank God for such faith. So they believe the impossible because he can if he wanted to. But sometimes, you know, I knew common sense. But at the same time, I'm thinking, well, you know, what should I do? You know, I tried to give him, and I gave him sense. And I said, sometimes you just got to accept it. But I don't want him, you understand, his faith to be shaken. He said, okay, Daddy, I'll accept it. Come on, somebody. But I'm going to tell you something tonight. Some of you have accepted the impossible in your life, and all it is a shoe taken away distance. He can do anything. Move anything. And he says, Moses, nothing can stop me. I just got to get you to take your shoes off. What is that thing that's between you and God? What is that thing that you're holding on to? I watched last night in a service the Holy Ghost go on pause. And the Holy Ghost said to me, it was like everything went in slow motion. When it did, I stopped. I was running back and forth, laying hands on everybody. I turned around and ran to the pulpit, grabbed the microphone. I said, the Holy Ghost just went on pause because somebody's wrestling with the decision whether or not you want to turn this loose. Am I telling it right, girls? Come on, somebody. I said, but the Holy Ghost said, it's red light right now, but the moment you let that thing go, green light's coming, and the Holy Ghost is going to run to you. And I'm telling you, it got quiet. We prayed. Some people got some breakthroughs. And then all of a sudden, I jumped back up there and grabbed the microphone because people were leaving. I'd done releasing people to go. You know, it's, you can go home if you want to. I grabbed the microphone. I said, there's some people think it's done dying down and it's over. But if you'll make a move, the red light's going to turn to green, and the Holy Ghost is going to unleash everything to come to your rescue. And I'm telling you about that time a man and woman got up from the back row and started down the aisle. When they did, the power of God was hit them and was giving them help and victory and deliverance before they could even get to the front. And all they had to do was take the shoe off. Who's ever going to play the piano? Come. Who ever do the altar call? You listen to me. Okay, come on, Allie. Watch this. When Samuel was in that with Eli, the Bible says that the voice of the Lord said to Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. He jumped up. Come here, baby. Lay down right there. He heard you. Just lay down across there. He said he heard the voice, Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. When he did, he jumped up and he ran. Jump up and he ran to Eli, and he said, Eli, he said, did you call me? And Samuel said, or Eli said, no, son, I didn't call you. Go back to bed. I don't got nothing to do with you. It's late. Go back to bed. And Samuel laid down again. The Bible said the lamp of the Lord was going out in the house of the Lord. Eli had waxed coat and his eyes dim, and he was allowing sin and prostitution in the sanctuary. But all of a sudden, the voice of God says, Samuel, Samuel, again, the circumstances don't stop God. Samuel come running and said, Eli, Eli, you called me again. He said, no, son, go back and lay down. I didn't call you. He went back and he heard the voice again. Watch this. The third time, Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. Somebody say, don't God change his mind and say something else? No. God's not going to the next level until you respond to the first. He laid back down and heard the same voice three times. Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. He runs back to him. Eli says, son, I perceive that the God of heaven is calling your name. So the next time you hear that voice, don't you jump up and run to me. You jump up, throw your hands up and say, speak, Lord, for thy servant hears. Watch this. He tells him the information. He tells him what to do. But watch this. He goes back and lays down. It still did not change God's mind. Knowing what to do still doesn't take God to the next level. God says there must be a response from you, even knowing what to do, even being taught what to do is not enough until you take what you've been taught to do and respond in action. At that moment, he heard. What did God say? He didn't go, okay, he knows what to do now. Samuel, get up and lift your hands and praise me. He didn't say that, did he? He said it the same thing again. Samuel, Samuel, Samuel. And when he jumped up, he throwed his hands up and said, here am I. Speak, Lord, your servant hears. And God went from Samuel, Samuel, Samuel to the next level of the revelation. Hallelujah. Thank you, son. I come to tell you tonight, some of you've never heard nothing more than God call your name. But if you'll lift your hands tonight and respond and say, speak, Lord. The Bible said Jesus walked on the water and would have passed them by, but they responded. And so tonight, on Thursday night, the Lord sent me to this conference to preach to you on a life of excuses or a life of passion. I hadn't even got there yet, but I'm going to ask you the question tonight. How long are you going to stay at the level you're at until you respond and say, I'm tired of just a burning bush experience. I'm tired of just hearing my name. I'm responding to the bush tonight. I'm responding to the voice. How many of you say, Brother Greg, I've had a burning bush experience? Come on, raise your hands. How many said, I've even drew close and heard him call my name and had a personal encounter.
But how many lift your hands and say, Brother Greg, I'm somewhere in the taking off the shoes. How many of you lift your hands and say, that's me, Pastor, God's talking to me. Come on, raise your hands. Come on, be honest with God. Come on, raise your hands. Be honest. Say, I got some stuff that I hadn't took off my shoes. Moses, if you can just get them shoes off, you're fixing to find out he's fixing to use you to break the entire empire of the known world. Crumbling. What's your name, buddy? Michael. God is waiting. How old are you? 13. God's waiting for a young man just like you to fall on that floor and say, Lord, here am I. I'll take my shoes off. Just use me. How old are you, baby? See, FFA? What are you? All right, awesome. God's waiting for young men just like you. Ordinary, as you go, as you live your life, young men and women, to say, I'm tired of being stuck at this level. Tonight I'm responding. Only one night, right? You got to go win some ball, huh? So tonight's your night. Some shoes you want to take off. Some shoes of pride, some shoes of lust, some shoes of whatever it is. Let God do what he wants to do in your life. If God's talking to you right now in the name of Jesus, that's the reason why the Holy Ghost stopped this and put me in this pulpit. That's why he didn't break through all the way. That's the reason why we didn't break through in the drama. It's because God wanted us to get to this place, because God says, I can move through this house, but I can't move past the shoes. If God's talking to you, I want you to stand to your feet right now all over this building. Come on, stand to your feet and say, Pastor Greg, I know exactly what. Stand to your feet saying, I know exactly what's between me and God tonight. There's no sense in wrestling with it anymore. And I'm ready to take my shoes off. I'm drawing near to that bush. I'm drawing near that bush. And I'm going to take my shoes off. Let's start coming all over this building. If you want to come help them, sing, right? Come on up and help them. Amen. Come on. Amen. Let's have an altar call tonight. Come on, strip these seats. You that are standing, let's strip them. Come stand, kneel. Amen. Come to the, if you want to, have some of you have, don't have room in the floor, let's come to the choir loft. But let's have, come on, come on. God's not finished in this house. Come on, but we can't go no further than this. The power of God.